Hello and welcome to Tempo Control. Let's get a musical grip together on games in time. My name is Peter Spezia, and it's time to count down the top 10 best songs from a specific video game soundtrack. Also coming up today on the show, PlayStation VR pricing and other GDC news, Xbox One and PS4 cross-network play coming to Rocket League, Digital Homicide sues Jim Sterling, and 5 way too early E3 2016 predictions. Now, before we talk game tunes and game news, remember that video game music is art, and art is subjective. We have a team that crafts our list in an attempt to be a definitive list for a specific title, and you may have your opinion on that list, so let us know in the comments below, on Twitter at Tempo Control, or at tempocontrolshow@gmail.com. We are brought to you by RhymesWithAsia.com. Before we recap the week of March 14th, 2016, in this 5th episode of the podcast, let's introduce this week's game. You have fallen into a mountain and landed in the underground. Monsters roam freely here, and they are particularly skeptical of human intrusion. After a brief encounter with a flower who is aptly named Flowey, you are rescued by the mother-like creature known as Toriel. She teaches you that the underground ruins are filled with puzzles, and that you don't have to beat up the enemies you encounter. Sparing these monsters through conversation can go a long way, after all. Toriel doesn't want you to leave the ruins, but you are anxious to see the rest of this world. So after you come to an understanding with her, Toriel decides to let you go on your own. The world is yours to explore, but what will you find? Who will you encounter? And just what is the truth about this place? The game is Undertale, and its soundtrack is in need of a proper countdown. So let's see what we have this time. In this piece, listen to how raw and dirty the bassline is throughout the track. As unsettling as it may seem at first, it's actually rather fitting when you consider its mechanical setting and nature. At number 10, it's Metal Crusher. Welcome back to Tempo Control. Especially during the last several years, the conference known as GDC, the Game Developers Conference, has become a place where certain news stories are either announced or during the week they are made known, so let's highlight some of them. We've been building up to it for the last few weeks, but it all starts with the PlayStation VR release date and pricing. And it turns out it's coming October 2016 with a price of $399 in the United States. And sure, we saw it was in that $399 box, but that didn't include the required PlayStation camera, the optional PlayStation Move controllers for some games, or any games period. So PlayStation decided to announce a launch bundle for PlayStation VR at $499, so $100 up, which includes that camera, two PlayStation Move controllers, and the 5-minigame launch title, PlayStation VR Worlds. Now, the first wave of pre-orders for that go up on Tuesday, March 22nd at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, but it's interesting to note that just the headset alone isn't planned to go on pre-order, really? Because I myself happen to have two Move controllers back from the PS3 days. I have that PlayStation camera because I was trying to do some streaming on PS4, so I have those, and I'm not in particular need of PlayStation VR Worlds, but I just like the headset, and that can't be pre-ordered. That seems a little strange. Maybe PlayStation's making it up as it goes along. It almost seems that way. But yeah, I like the price point a lot. I think it's very fitting. Sony doesn't have to operate at a loss for this. And when you consider that you don't have to have an expensive PC to run this, just a PlayStation 4, I think that's very fair. I think the launch bundle is a really good value for those that are missing those required and optional parts. And I particularly like the cinematic mode of PlayStation VR. The idea that you can play any PlayStation 4 content in a cinematic mode, just like with three different levels of zoom, I think that would work very well. So it's not just VR games, and I think that works out very well for if PlayStation VR has a future in the experiences realm that go beyond just games with VR. What I don't like, yeah, I wish the headset just had a pre-order all on its own. And also, these little bundled-in earbuds, I mean, come on, that's ridiculous. I hope that it's comfortable to wear at least a good pair of isolation headphones, because it really, VR is also going to be about the sound, just as it is the visuals. Anyway, some more quick hits. Moving away from VR, Zero Time Dilemma, the third game in the Zero Escape series, was confirmed at a panel to have a release date of June 28th, 2016, for 3DS and Vita. And man, I can't wait for Zero Time Dilemma. It's one of my top 5 anticipated games of the year. It's also going to be coming to Steam later this year, and they were kind of teasing the possibility of maybe the first 2 Zero Escape games are going to be coming to Steam as well. I mean, that's not confirmed, but they were kind of hinting at that, and I'd really like to see that, get more people playing those games. Because it seems like that's what these smaller Japanese studios are trying to do. I mean, you've seen the Danganronpa games moving from Vita to Steam, and now maybe the Zero Escape games as well. So I'm really excited, can't wait to see Zero Time Dilemma in my hands, see the resolution of that story. The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt won the grand prize at the IGF GDC Awards, which apparently makes it the most awarded video game of all time, and that really means I should play it soon. It's important to note that Undertale was nominated for a few awards, but oh. Hours after hosting a Women in Video Gaming luncheon, Microsoft decided to throw a party that featured scantily clad women in schoolgirl outfits. Now, they're apologizing company-wide. Phil Spencer saying that, like, does not represent us at all. They're going to have a talking to with whoever set that up, and someone's definitely getting fired, but a really bad look there for Microsoft. During a Capcom localization panel, we saw this screenshot. Don't drive to meme country. Very good advice, because for good localization, you want to borrow the humor of the game and kind of implement it for a Western audience, but don't just rely on memes. You've been seeing certain companies kind of rely on that a little too heavily, and it gets a little cringeworthy. From Monster Hunter to Nintendo news, Miitomo is now out in Japan on mobile devices, and will be out in the United States by the end of the month, according to Reggie Fils-Aimé. Not only that, but on the rumor front, we got a photo of what looks to be a possible NX controller prototype. This was reported at large by Destructoid, and it does match an old Nintendo patent. I personally think it looks ergonomically awful, and I hope it isn't true at all, but it's one of those, if it comes true, we saw it here first. And finally, Kotaku got wind of PS4.5 discussion at GDC, and they followed up with a couple other sources. It's a really interesting write-up by Patrick Klepek. And it goes back to the discussion of upgradable consoles that we had a couple weeks ago. I mean, Phil Spencer talking about it possibly for Xbox One and then backed off on those comments, and now we're hearing stuff like this. Maybe this is the future of consoles, and I don't know if that's a good or bad thing, but you can go back and check out our discussion if you want more in-depth stuff with that. It's always an interesting time at GDC. I mean, we're a few months out from E3. Speaking of E3, we'll talk more about that later in the show. In this piece, listen to how such a simple melody builds over time as more and more instruments are added. It's a longer track, but the emotion here runs high as you're in the final stretch of the game. At number 9, it's Undertale. Thank you.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb and the shape of an L on her forehead. Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming. Fed to the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets smart but your head gets dumb. So much to do, so much to see. So what's wrong with taking the back streets? You'll never know if you don't go. You'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on, get paid. Stars break the mold.
In this piece, listen to how many layers are involved, especially when the heavy drums kick in. You are lost in its complexity, almost like you're trapped in a web. At number 8, it's Spider Dance. Welcome back to Tempo Control. An interesting announcement this past week, almost historic in a way, as Microsoft announced that it was opening up its Xbox Live network to the idea of cross-network play, starting with Psyonix's Rocket League. That's right, it's the idea of Xbox One players and PlayStation 4 players playing together on the same game. Of course, the bridge here is PC. I mean, PlayStation 4 and PC players have been able to play together on Rocket League for quite some time. And now that Rocket League has come to Xbox One, and well, that makes sense with Windows 10, that's almost inherent, the bridge is able to be connected that way. Of course, it's still on the developer to handle this connection, to bridge the gap, as it were. And, you know, these big console manufacturers can only provide support in a way, but it's really a developer initiative, and that's what Rocket League's doing with its big success. So what did PlayStation say when it was asked for comment? It says, quote, PlayStation has been supporting cross-platform play between PC on several software titles, starting with Final Fantasy XI on PS2 and PC back in 2002. We would be happy to have the conversation with any publishers or developers who are interested in cross-platform play. Sony, guys, come on, this isn't the place for corporate one-upsmanship. It's about bringing games together, bringing players together, bringing rivalries together, and you throw out 2002 and come off a little bit boastful here, I think you've just worked fine with the second half of the quote there. So of course, yes, it's still very early stages, and these are closed networks after all. The bridge here is PC, and maybe these multi-platform games are just the first step. So it's nice to see with Rocket League kind of a beginning of what may come, but I don't think we're at a point where it's all sunshine and rainbows and everyone's holding hands here. But this is a headline that went outside the game industry, so it's interesting to note at its place in time that Rocket League may be a pioneer in that Xbox One, PS4 crossplay. In this piece, listen to the swing beat that is so unique to the series of tracks that are associated with it. Between that and the pseudo-vocal instrument track, you really kind of feel like you're in a swanky jazz club. At number 7, it's Dummy. Welcome back. So real quickly, what games am I playing this week? I finished The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess HD. Great game, good improvement on the original. Had a lot of fun with it, and I really did a lot in this game this time around. I got all of the bugs for Agatha, which I had never done before, and that was a nice reward of a $2,000 wallet instead of a $1,000. The boost from 1,000 instead of 600 when you just bring your one bug, that was a really nice touch. But overall, it was nice to have the Cave of Shadows with the Wolf Link amiibo. It's kind of a Cave of Ordeal sort of thing, where floor after floor, but you're Wolf Link instead. And those armored dinosaurs with the heavy iron plates, those are just tough, especially when you have multiple of those as vulnerable Wolf Link. I even ended up 3 heart pieces shy of getting that full heart container. I didn't do the extra block puzzles, the ice block puzzles. I didn't want to do the flying up the river, collecting the oranges and strawberries for Plum. And I did not want to race downhill with Yetto and Yetta. That just seems really ridiculous. But yeah, so much fun with Twilight Princess HD, put about 25 hours into it. These other games, The Division didn't arrive for us until a couple days ago, so it was like a week and a half from Gamefly saying they sent it out to it actually arriving. That's kind of crazy. And then I'm about to leave for this business trip, so maybe some more Fire Emblem Fates on the plane. Now, video game composers don't get nearly enough credit, and that's something we'd like to change here at Tempo Control. Undertale's main composer is Toby Fox, born October 11th, 1991. And that's right, not only is he the game's main composer, he's the game's developer as well. Fox was originally a member of Starmen.net, which is a popular Earthbound fan forum, where he went by the name of Radiation. He led up the PK Hack part of the forum, which is focusing on ROM hacks for Earthbound. From there, Fox is known for making a popular Halloween hack of Earthbound, where his song Megalovania was the final boss theme, and so it makes sense that that song was carried over for a newer rendition in Undertale. Fox's composition experience also extends to the webcomic Homestuck, of all things. So Toby Fox, thank you. Not only did you create a wonderful game, but you composed a killer soundtrack as well. In this piece, listen to how that rhythm right at the beginning just gets you moving right in time with it. You know, I'd make some sort of pun for this, but I just don't have the heart to do it, so I can't soldier on. At number 6, it's Bone Trousel. Welcome back to Tempo Control, and oh my goodness, Digital Homicide sued Jim Sterling. Now, if that's just a bunch of word soup for you and you haven't been following this fiasco that's lasted almost over the last 2 years, let's kind of summarize things for you. Digital Homicide is an independent game developer infamously known for creating Slaughtering Grounds, a shoddy first-person shooter that critic Jim Sterling featured on a YouTube video in November 2014. Sterling dubbed it as the new worst game of 2014 contender, and a game where the awfulness just doesn't stop, noting how many assets were lifted from the Unity store without any artistic alteration. Now Digital Homicide threw internet hissy fits, making text-based response videos to Sterling, deleting any fan feedback that was negative on its Steam page, and even trying to issue DMCA takedown notices for Sterling's videos. Unsuccessfully, I might add. Over time, Digital Homicide would seem to stoop to new lows, pushing out tons of terribly made games on the Steam store under different company names, including the already established Polish developer ECC Games. They tried to do a gotcha-style interview with Jim Sterling where they came off looking terribly. It was just the works. It kept getting worse for them. But Digital Homicide's problem was that they took criticism personally, that they never developed the thick skin that you need when you're going into a creative field like video game development. So in the ultimate move of pettiness, they are filing a lawsuit against Jim Sterling, whose real name is actually James Stanton, who knew, for emotional, financial, and reputational distress, direct product damage, and punitive damages. For how much, you might ask? For $10 million. Did I mention that they're representing themselves legally at the moment? That they're trying to crowdsource fund a lawyer that they claim is really good? You know, if they had a case, any lawyer would flock to them. They would have a lawyer easily, but they don't have a case really. Of course, Sterling is justifiably staying quiet on the matter, but he feels pretty confident that he couldn't fight this very well and that this should be a frivolous lawsuit. There is much more to this story, especially if you view Jim Sterling's content regularly like I do. He's one of the best game critics on the net, and so do watch his Digital Homicides videos where he's documented every shoddy business practice that this company's done, and you'll really see that this company doesn't have much of a case. Go support Jim Sterling on Patreon. He makes a living doing what he loves, and he is damn good at it. God bless you, Jim fucking Sterling, son. Behind you 100%. In this piece, listen to how full the sound is when all the instruments contribute to this dance beat. It's one of the most entertaining tracks to listen to on loop, most because of how it can just make you move. At number 5, it's Death by Glamour. Welcome back. Now it's nice to look back, but let's take a look at the old calendar and see what games are coming out this week that we can't wait to play. Day of the Tentacle Remastered, coming March 22nd to PC, PS4, and Vita.
Oh great, I'm stuck in colonial times. Tentacles are taking over the world. Time for me to save the world, I guess.
The full version of Republique, coming March 22nd to PC, PS4, iOS, and Android.
So with 5 unique episodes, voiceover performances from legends like David Hayter, Jennifer Hale, Dwight Schultz, Republic has been a labor of love.
Trackmania Turbo, coming March 22nd to PC, PS4, and Xbox One. Impressive! Dead or Alive Extreme 3, coming March 24th in Japan to PS4 and Vita. And Hyrule Warriors Legends, coming March 25th to 3DS. Which game are you looking forward to playing the most? Let us know in the comments below. In this piece, listen to the contrast of the full triumphant melody and the meager piano that follows it. It's a battle track that's all over the place as you take on the king. At number 4, it's Bergen Trukung, followed by Asgore. Thank you. Welcome back to Tempo Control. E3 is less than 3 months away. So I figure let's have some way too early E3 2016 predictions. I mean, why not? It's E3, you gotta start making predictions. So I have five of them for you, multiple parts, so let's get right into it. Number five, Nintendo NX will be revealed as Nintendo Cross. It will launch on November 18th, 2016 in North America for an MSRP of $349.99. The definitive complete version of Super Smash Bros. For Wii U will be launched as a launch title. Number 4. Ubisoft will close their press conference with Watch Dogs 2. It will take place in San Francisco. The surprise? It's coming this year, November 15th, 2016. Number 3. Valve will make an appearance at the PlayStation conference to announce not Half-Life 3, not Portal 3, but Left 4 Dead 3. It will come in 2017. Number 2, we will get confirmation from Microsoft about the backwards compatibility of Red Dead Redemption on Xbox One. To follow this up, Microsoft will bring Rockstar on stage for them to announce the next Red Dead game, Red Dead Retribution. Coming holiday 2016. And number one, two of the following games will be announced for Virtual Console for either Nintendo NX, Wii U, or 3DS. Pokemon Gold, Silver, and Crystal, Mother 3, or Super Smash Bros. Melee. Those are my predictions. It's way too early 3 months out from E3, but it's getting so close. If you have any predictions that are out there, you want to get them on paper or digital ink, I guess? Let us know in the comments below. In this piece, listen to the frenetic pace that just hits you right when the main beat kicks in. You've chosen your path, but now it's time for you to face a familiar foe who won't fall so easily. At number 3, it's Battle Against a True Hero. Welcome back. You've sent us questions via email, Twitter, Facebook, so let's answer one. What do you think is the secret to Stardew Valley's surprise success? Interesting question. I think there are a few things that goes with it. First of all, the retro aesthetic definitely helps. It's very popular at the moment. Also, the solo developer effort is very easy to get behind. In this case, it's Concerned Ape, but retro game with a solo developer, does that sound familiar? Yeah, it's Undertale. It's almost following that success to a T. But of course, the genre on Stardew Valley is very different. It's a Harvest Moon farming simulator sort of game, kind of borrowing also some Animal Crossing elements, I think, as well. And the retro Harvest Moon games are something that a lot of people have a lot of nostalgia for. You know, Harvest Moon does have some newer games, but those older games on PlayStation, maybe some GameCube, people have a lot of fondness for that, and to kind of harken back to that with an even more retro aesthetic, it's very appealing to a lot of people. But why is it so popular? It's really a sign of the times with the Twitch and YouTube culture. People streaming it, getting it out there, kind of a grassroots support for it. Let's Plays out there. Really shows that these, you know, newer platforms can help bring a new game to the forefront of the gamer culture and kind of expand it that way. Again, a lot of similarities there to Undertale. So while it's not my kind of game, I'm very happy to see Stardew Valley do very well. These indie game efforts that, you know, a solo developer just pours their heart and soul into the game, it's always great to see it get rewarded. And that's really the case with this game. Thank you for your question. Let us know if there are any others you'd like us to answer. Twitter at TempoControl or email at TempoControlShow@gmail.com. In this piece, listen to the fusion of the different instruments that combine and make this piece totally work. Electric guitars, strings, 8-bit synthesizers, it all comes together to reach epic proportions when your determination reaches new heights. At number 2, it's Hopes and Dreams, followed by Save the World. Welcome back. So, my memories of Undertale are an interesting one. I actually wanted to have my wife record something for this, but she's been having a very, very busy week with more than 12-hour long days training for a new job, so just couldn't make it work. Because this was the first game on this list of games so far for tempo control. It's the first game that I haven't beaten all the way through. Let me explain, though. It was through my wife that I had heard of Undertale, because she was starting to stream it on her Twitch channel, and I tuned in and watched a lot of it, and it's a game that's really easy to watch, especially for someone like me who has difficulty with bullet hell games. It's something I wanted to watch. But I think this brings up a point with Let's Play culture, is that when these big story revelation moments occur, and you're not the one actively participating and having your own player agency and choice involved, and you're just a passive spectator, they don't hit home as well as they really should. Which is unfortunate because Undertale has a great story. I just experienced too much of it for myself before actually playing it for myself. So, I mean, I tried a pacifist run and I got to Snowdin Town, but it got to the point where I knew too much, and that was really a detriment to my experience. Maybe I'm getting old, but I really like watching games when I've completed the games, or if I need help with a really tight spot, or if I'm at the end of the game and I've had too many attempts on the final boss and I just want to see the ending. So really, for a game like Undertale, I really wish I had given it a shot playing it before I watched as much of it as I did, because I love the story, I love the characters, but it would have meant so much more to me had I been the one playing it instead of just watching someone else play it. Though I can still definitely appreciate all its artistry, its writing, and especially the music. I love, love, love this soundtrack. Now, when you make a top 10 list for a game soundtrack, not everything will make the cut. That said, here are a few that we had a hard time leaving on the cutting room floor. Before we get to our number one song, here's a quick recap. Number 10, Metal Crusher. Number 9, Undertale. Number 8, Spider Dance. Number 7, Dummy. Number 6, Bone Trousel. Number 5, Death by Glamour. Number 4, Bergentrückung and Asgore. Number 3, Battle Against a True Hero. And number 2, Hopes and Dreams and Save the World. In this piece, listen to how it's a beautiful day outside. Birds are singing, flowers are blooming. On days like this, people like you should have this song and boss battle overwhelm your senses. At number one, it's Megalovania. And that's the list. Thank you so much for watching and listening. I'm really glad we got to cover the Undertale soundtrack because it really was one of the best soundtracks of last year and maybe even the last 5 years. So really glad we got to focus on this one. YouTube video recommendation this week, let's go to Jim Sterling and watch one of his latest Jimquisition features called Ub Iconic, talking about Ubisoft using the word iconic so inappropriately. He does great stuff. Please go support him. Make sure you join us next week for Killer Instinct Season 2. We'll talk about both seasons on the Xbox One because they share the same great kick-ass soundtrack. To play us out, let's highlight our favorite fan rendition of this game's soundtrack in our Remix of the Week. And it comes from Ben Briggs, who took a really happy, bouncy song and added some interesting dynamics to it. It's called Tem Shop Glitch Hop Remix. You'll want to check it out. Thank you so much for tuning in. I gotta go catch a flight and probably edit this podcast on it. My name is Peter Spezia, and we'll see you next week on Tempo Control.